Hi there, my name is Nate Ridgway and welcome to my next vlog on inventive ways to use class time in the classroom. Today what we're calling this vlog is Get Out after the Jordan Peele film, but it's about escape rooms and how to use escape rooms with class time. If you don't know what an escape room is or you're not familiar with this phenomenon, they're all over now Hollywood, and you can go to them for like recreational entertainment. Basically, the premise is you get a series of clues that kind of lead you to other clues, and then eventually your goal is to escape the room where you're at. What we're going to be doing here is actually creating one of these for our students using class time. That's kind of what the feature of this video will show. Now, if you're not, again, you've never done one of these in the classroom before, there's a whole bunch of reasons why you should probably give even just a very basic escape room a try. The engagement level is really the main reason. They're extremely engaging for students because either they're familiar with, you know, escape rooms, or just simply the idea that their lives are on the line to get out can be really something that grabs their attention. I think, though, there is a fair, you know, bit to kind of explain here with, you know, attention grabbing. And I've made this very scientific graph here for you of what I think tends to happen with students' attention levels and how engaged they are during a class period. And so if you look at our, again, very scientific, very authoritative graph over here, tending, like, with what I've noticed with my students over time is that as a lesson's going on, my school, we have 80-minute blocks, is that as that time goes on, the engagement level just kind of drops off. And here what we're doing is kind of we're flipping that on its head, that actually as time goes on, it gets more interesting because, again, the whole point is to actually escape. And again, there's kind of a time component with that. So as, you know, time goes on, that kind of tension and excitement level goes up. So that's kind of the reason that we're doing this here, is that we're trying to make your, you know, your teaching. We're not trying to replace it anyway, or you know, like, basically we're saying we're not trying to compromise the instruction that you're actually doing. We're trying to make it more attractive for students and more engaging so that they do remember it and get something out of it. Now, also, as we're going on here, I am going to show a few examples that I have done here in the classroom, and I will also be showing how I use class time with this. Please make sure that you remember that you don't have to do all this at once. If you've never heard of escape rooms before, or the whole thing sounds very intimidating, totally understandable. Start small. So what I'm going to do here is show you an example of how I did that, and also how I use class time with mine. So being that I was at this time first introducing the idea of an escape room to students, I'm going to open up just one lesson that I did with them in particular. And I'm also going to share this with you as well, so you can go through and peruse it at your leisure. And I'm just going to actually pull up the lesson for them on Google Slides. It was the exact same thing that they had access to. And you can kind of see this was the first time that I was introducing this concept to them. And you also see you get an interesting kind of take on how I used class time to actually accomplish this. Okay, so the objective that I had for the students that day was to explain the rise and decline of the Mughal Empire through three important leaders. And what I told students was at the very beginning was as I was kind of sitting down and actually setting the expectations of how the escape room worked and how I wanted them to work inside the escape room. So what we did is we were just like really sitting down with students and explaining to them, here's how I want you to cooperate. Here's how, you know, like I want you to attack the clues. Like when you're done, please make sure you reset the puzzles, all that kind of good stuff. And so what they were then thrown into, and I will just pull this up on the full screen view, okay, is the actual experience started on this slide themselves. So they had to go over here. They had to click the countdown button, and then it takes them to this screen, okay? And because this was my student's first time, I really wanted to heavily scaffold them through it, okay? Also, for me personally, I'm a big, kind of a big proponent of differentiation in the classroom. So over here, you can see that the students had a warm-up back a few slides ago, and if they got better than an 80% on it, that actually changed how they escaped for the rest of the lesson. So all the students had to prove to me that they got 80% or better on it. And then what I did to verify that was they first had a Google form to go and do. And so they had a passcode in here that they had to type in to verify that they actually either watched the review video if they got less than 80%, Or what I did for those students that did pass is I actually went around and I gave them on a small slip of paper the passcode. Then what it is, they had kind of a choice between two different materials to look at. They had a kind of another resource to do. And then the lock that actually got them out of the room was a tool that I used on Classtime. And this is kind of what I'm going to be showing off today, is actually how I did this. So we're just going to go ahead and pretend like we were a student that day. And what they had to do was, in that activity that they did, they had a key that they got, and I can show you that here in a minute. And in class time, they had to show me that they did the activity and they understood what they needed to get by knowing or by showing me they knew how to cut the wires in a particular order. So here's the other resource that students got when they came in. You can see down here actually is the key that they would use to figure out how they were going to be cutting the wires. So again, you can kind of start to see these kind of component parts start to fit together. And again, this takes time. I'm not at all going to sugarcoat that. It does take time. But the trade-off is you put a little bit more time into it and the engagement level is much, much higher. Here was their actual hint. The order to cut the wires is, and then it gives them the steps. But again, they would have to go off that student key of all the wires to figure out how this would work. And then they have to go through the activities as well. Speaking more about how I actually used class time to accomplish this, you can see that I only used class time for one clue. And when I was first introducing escape rooms to my students, that's really all I wanted to do. I wanted to start small. I didn't want to overwhelm them with either the number of puzzles or the depth that the puzzles are requiring them to kind of figure things out. I wanted it to be challenging, but not too much. What I now want to show you is basically from here, how did I go about using class time in some really different ways to come up with even more clues, even more puzzles, and then just fundamentally, how would I use class time as a kind of escape tracker for all of my students as they went throughout the escape experience. Okay, so that's kind of what we're going to be focusing on. How can it serve as a platform for students to enter a diverse variety of clues? And then how can students use it to self-track their escape progress? So puzzle solving. A key to any escape room, obviously, is the puzzles that students have to solve. We're going to be using class time as basically a puzzle hub where students can punch in their answers. And eventually, here in a minute, we'll talk about how they can use it as kind of like a self-check to see if they actually did escape. These are 10 different things, though, 10 different puzzles that I came up with to use in class time. And again, I have this set down below that you can use and you can copy into your own libraries. Please feel free to steal them as much as you'd like to. Okay, so just a very basic password is one. Over here, same idea, just a series of numbers. Down below, again, now using the multiple choice options on class time, having students select the wrong answer, statement, fact. Over here is a little bit different. Now we're using the grid option that's available on class time answers. And so the students have to, again, more complicated clues, you'll notice as we're going down here. But students have to, you know, have, oh, it's A1, B3, C2, D4 is the correct way to get out. And they would be able to figure their way out there. Again, the wire cutting option that I just showed earlier. You could add, again, more wires to make the puzzle more complex. Over on the right here is a very different kind of key. It's a cipher code. And so you can give students a passcode, but then force them to punch it into a cipher for the puzzle to become a little bit more complicated, a little bit more interesting. Team clues. This is one of my favorite ideas that I kind of came up with, is that you can use grouping in your escape room to make your escape room more collaborative. So what I've done here is I just came up with a series of very random statements, and what would happen is that certain groups would get the basically the clues that this statement was true. So that all dolphins meow would be true, all elephants roar would be true, and then all cats glub would be true. Now again, like, students would only be able to find out that these are the correct ones by talking to either the other individual students in class or the other groups in class. And so it kind of forces it to become collaborative. Over here is a tool selector. This is using the answer highlight feature on class time. And so the students are picking the correct tool they need to use in a situation. And then down below, I kind of have my last couple ones. We have the pathing password, which students would be given some kind of like actual map that you would draw some kind of particular path on. And then they might take a picture. You might take a picture of letters, like a very simple like word, you know, finder picture out there. You can, they're all over Google. You can find them. And then what I did is then they would have to, as you can kind of see in the GIF here, they would have to use that drawing you gave along with the picture of the words, and they would have to type in the password. Last one is a padlock, and very simply, again, it's just dragging and dropping the correct combinations into order. And those are the 10 that I came up with. Now, of course, as class time continues, I'm sure to add in different kinds of questions that you can do. The number of different possibilities of puzzles that you can make will infinitely increase. If you'd like to borrow this set of puzzles for your own use in your own escape room, please absolutely do so. Now, how can you actually use class time in a different way besides just for puzzles for your students? I would recommend that you can actually use it as a way that students can kind of self-regulate themselves. And there's kind of a couple of questions, I guess, before actually doing this. Now, what I mean by that is, if you want to have class time serve as a companion, as I said here, to your escape room experience, you want to make sure you're kind of thinking about, well, is this escape room trying to measure mastery or performance? So if you're trying to have your students do mastery, I would really recommend that you show the teacher dashboard up at the front of the room. And the reason why is by showing that, and for example, like I have a projector over the front of my room, the students can tell like, oh, I got that question wrong. That means I can't escape. I need to go back to that clue and see what I did wrong. And it forces mastery. Now, if you don't show the teacher dashboard, and for example, you don't allow students to go back and recorrect their answers, now you're actually using it to assess performance. And that's a little bit different. So basically, it kind of comes down to whether or not you want to show the teacher dashboard at the front of the room. For me, in my first time of doing this, I did show this up at the front of the room because it was students' first escape attempt. And this was really, really successful because they're like, oh, my combination didn't work there. I cut the wires in the wrong order. And they went back and fixed it. Also, something to think about is when you're deciding to use class time as a companion, do you want there to be more or less pressure on your students when they're escaping? If you choose to, and I think it's a very powerful thing in the right cases, if you choose to use a timer, that can really heighten the tension and the drama that students are feeling as they're trying to escape. Because again, like if they have a limited amount of time to punch these into class time, that certainly is going to increase the excitement and the pressure that they're feeling. Now, of course, you have to be careful about this because for students who don't deal well with pressure or for students who need accommodations in your classroom, this can kind of backfire. So again, it kind of depends on your students. And of course, that should come down to you and what you decide is better. Now, what settings should you run with as class time overall? I've always run these ones, shuffle answer options. And with the session timer, again, that's kind of up to you. The one that you may or may not choose is this shuffle questions. The only reason that you might turn this one on is because if you decide to shuffle questions, that means that students will have to collect all the clues before they go to class time. If you don't shuffle the questions, that means they're kind of returning to class time as they're solving the clues. I would kind of think about in your particular circumstances what works best. Here at the very bottom of the blog post, I've included a resource that has tons and tons of stuff on escape rooms generally. You are more than welcome. Sarah Wilking, she's another Indiana teacher, shared this with me a few years ago, and it's got some really good stuff that other teachers have made. It's right here, and you can click on it. But other than that, hopefully you will find that class time will make a really kind of interesting companion for you and your students in their escape rooms. Other than that, happy escaping. Bye-bye.